गुड आफ्टरनून डॉक्टर श्रीनिवासन सर. गुड आफ्टरनून, गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल पार्टिसिपेंट्स. टुडे वी हैव वेरी स्पेशल स्पीकर ऑन वेरी स्पेशल टॉपिक ऑन क्रायोजेनिक्स. डॉक्टर श्रीनिवासन सर इज वर्किंग विद लो टेम्परेचर फैसिलिटी एट टाटा इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ फंडामेंटल रिसर्च मुंबई सिंस ईयर 1999. ही इज हैविंग मोर देन 22 इयर्स ऑफ एक्सपीरियंस विद TIFR. Sir is working as an in charge for low temperature facility at TIFR Mumbai. He has also served as a visiting faculty for the graduate student in TIFR, Indian Neutrino Observatory, MSc student from Mumbai University, and also in the Center of Excellence in Basic Sciences, Mumbai. Also, he contributes as a technical expert, technical advisor, we say that, for different cryogenic facilities in IESR or IITs or NITs or central universities. Also, he is a research collaborated with funded projects with ISRO, DRDO, then BRNS. And also, sir has served with Indian Cryogenic Council as a secretary. Has presented more than 60 technical talks in field of cryogenic. Also, having more than 20 publications in peer-reviewed journals and conferences. His key area on cryocooler, heat transfer, additive manufacturing, and automation. And also, we are lucky that sir is always inspiring students of cryogenic. We have also visited sir laboratory for more than 4 times every alternate year. From especially from Ahmedabad, we took students to LTF facility TIFR Mumbai. Sir is always helpful in the session for the cryogenic students or the students who are interested to work in low temperature facility. He also provided the training support to the students all the time when we need. So straight away, I request Dr. Srinivasan sir to start the session, please, sir.
Yeah. Also, thank you very much.
Aditi Shah, who is the president of ISRO Ahmedabad chapter, who has joined along with Aditi. Aditi Shah is the president of ISRO Ahmedabad chapter.
Hi, good evening, sir.
Thank you.
Welcome to the ISRO Ahmedabad chapter. We're glad to have you on board. Hardik sir has. Told us so many things about you. We thank you so much for joining for today's session.
Thank you very much.
And Rajendra, I request keep Paliwal sir in panelist also. Sir, Professor Paliwal from LD College of Engineering. You have heard sir's name. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Can I share the screen then?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes.
Is it viewable?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. And thank you very much, Brother Hardik Shukla ji and the ISRO Ahmedabad chapter for giving me an opportunity to present a lecture on cryogenics. So let me just straight into the topic. Okay. So the cryogenics is basically, it's very, very special subject in the sense that it's a branch of physics as well as engineering, because it deals with extremely low temperatures, in particular the refrigeration, liquefaction, production, storage, transport, and application. Of course, the study of various phenomena, everything else. So basically, most of the applications are comes under physics point of view, whereas the production, storage, preservation and transportation, everything comes under the kind of engineering. So it's a very, very peculiar subject in terms of its application and then production point of view. So best of all, that when you are on the temperature or cryogenics or low temperature, the first thing is that how do you denote your temperature thing? So we always in cryogenics has to use only the Kelvin scale. Because we know that there are so many temperature scales like, you know, Kelvin, Celsius, Rankine, Fahrenheit. So many units are there. So we always wanted to be more specific in terms of communication. So the in that sense, Kelvin scale is chosen in the sense because the absolute zero, where you have a definite low temperature, is been fixed at 0 Kelvin. From there, you start counting from the up. So if it is a 0 Kelvin or absolute zero, that is equal to minus 273.15. In fact, it is more precise. We can see in the further slide. So that is the lowest temperature possible thing. And even then, that lowest temperature, absolute zero, is only a theoretical limit and is not practically achievable. Okay. So in that sense, 0 Kelvin, and we start counting from up. So then everything will be a positive integer. In that sense, it becomes more convenient in conversation. For example, instead of absolute zero mentioning as minus 273.15, then you add minus 269.69 for the helium. So it becomes very difficult in communication. So it will become easy if it is 4.2K Kelvin, 77K nitrogen, 90K oxygen. It becomes easy to convince. So in that sense, in cryogenics, always Kelvin change is used. And other thing people would normally would say that when you say degree Celsius, degree Fahrenheit, degree Rankine, Kelvin is not degree Kelvin, it's just simply Kelvin. Okay. Now, let us see. For example, we see that 0 degree Celsius, that's a freezing point of water, ice temperature. And when we go on the higher end, on the positive end, if you go to something like 100 degree Celsius, where the water boils, boiling point of water, and then we go to 1000 degree Celsius, 2000 degree Celsius, 3000, or maybe the iron core where melt, and 6000 degree Celsius, where the core of the sun, and it goes to higher temperature. In fact, there are some stars which are 10 to the power 9 degrees Celsius or Kelvin. Okay. So basically, if you start from zero and go on the higher end, almost you are in an infinite range, and 0 degree Celsius to almost infinite. Whereas when you come from the lower end, zero to below, it stops very precisely at minus 273.15, nothing below that. Okay. So when you compare zero to infinite on the other end, and zero to 273 is almost insignificant delta in the lower end, but there is a lot of property changes at the temperature that gives significant that cryogenics is something more interesting to study or to see about. So what I want to say is that whatever is happening at the higher temperature, more or less, it will behave in an opposite way in the low temperature. It's not a straightforward thing, but for the sake of understanding. Now, when you say that what low is low, so there's always a confusion. So internationally, they have agreed anything starts from minus 150 degrees Celsius to absolute zero, that is minus 273, that band, we call it as a cryogenic band. Remaining thing can be at refrigeration or advanced refrigeration. So in that sense, normally we mention room temperature as 300 Kelvin, which is something close to 27 degrees Celsius. And if you see that this point 1, 2, 3K, that is a start point, anything below is cryogenics, anything above is advanced refrigeration or refrigeration. So that is the area. So in that sense, oxygen liquefies at 90 Kelvin. Air as such liquefies at about 78, 79 Kelvin. Nitrogen liquefies at boiling point is about 77. Hydrogen is about 20. And helium is 4.2K. The specialty of helium is the thing. At this temperature of 4.2K, anything you name that would have been frozen at the temperature, nothing remains. Helium is the only element which remains in a liquid form at this temperature. Everything else would have been frozen at the temperature. So something in the lowest temperature possible available in the liquid form is easy to handle. So that gives an, I think most of the research, they always lie with the liquid nitrogen and liquid helium, both are being a inert, and the lowest temperature possible with the helium. So all that research happens, and the fundamental research happens with nitrogen and helium. So with this background, let us go inside that into the topic that why we need to have a cryogenic. Why do we need a cryogenic? As a TIFR is basically devoted to fundamental research. The one of the key element is to know the properties of matter at various temperature. Okay, because we know the property changes with temperature. For example, you know the electrical resistance. When you reduce the temperature, resistance reduces with the reducing in temperature. Of course, that will go to another facility called superconductivity. It will have superconductivity when you go further down. So, and you want to have further done. For example, when you are going into fundamental physics or the quantum level physics, where you're going for each atom wise, where the thermal noise is a nuisance. We have to, when you want to go on the fundamental studies or the quantum level studies, you have to reduce the thermal effect by reducing the temperature, because basically vibration of atoms is the temperature. The more the temperature, more the vibration. So we need to go to a kind of an as close to zero or absolute zero to so study the properties in better. So that also we need to have cryogenic. And there are certain phenomena like superconductivity, superfluidity, which occurs only at cryogenic temperature. For example, if you want to have a superconductivity or superfluidity, you can't do anything else unless you reach the cryogenic temperature. Now, these are the reason that we need cryogenics, but in case of general application of cryogenics, okay, why you need to have a general, what are the general applications are available so that the common man or the general public or the society can benefit out of it? And if that is so, how do we achieve the temperature? So these are the two questions we are trying to understand. Now, about the requirement, you say, why you need cryogenics? I put it in two bandwidth, cryogenics before birth or cryogenics after death. So it sufficiently covers the entire span of the life. So we see that, is there any cryogenics? Yes, we have cryogenics application is there before birth. You must have heard about the IVF, in vitro fertilization, where the embryos are stored in liquid nitrogen temperature and kind of a suspended animation for an indefinite period so that it can be used whenever it's taken. So more of the surrogation birth is possible because embryos are stored biological, because people with some issues with their conceiving can go for surrogacy using their become the biological parents of the child. So the cryopreservation process, embryos are deep frozen in liquid nitrogen temperature where it can be suspended animation. So that there are so many applications that, in fact, nowadays more young couple we are going for the major operation, they try to preserve their sperms or egg or embryo as such to in the low temperature so that it can be used in the later form. Okay, though that's also it, particularly when they are going for the chemotherapy, young people would like to have these kind of stem cells or the embryos preserved that. So it is before birth, there is an application is that. Now coming to the other end, the application of cryogenics after death. In fact, there is a separate topic called cryonics, which is a preservation of legally dead humans, a pet or organ at low temperature, of course, in liquid nitrogen temperature, in the hope that a future technology or medical miracle will come and their life can be restored. So these are the presence of most of the body assets or the organs or the pet, all these things are stored in liquid nitrogen temperature so that we in the belief that we can have a birth after some point of time. In fact, there is a very well prescribed procedures are available. How do we cool the body? If it is only sir legally pronounced death, then you remove all the water component from the body, because when you cool oxygen, the water will freeze and then crack the shell and rupture the tissue. So you remove all these water component and replace with an anti-freezing element, glycerin, and then cool it with liquid nitrogen. They normally, this kind of whatever, they put many bodies upside down in the sense that even if the nitrogen level goes down, the brain is still within the liquid nitrogen temperature. So this thing, there are many labs are available because many countries do not accept this preservation of bodies legally, but some countries do allow that. So there are many industries available to preserve the body, which is obviously available in the website. Okay, now having seen that, there is a huge potential for cryogenics. Now the next question is, how do we get the temperature? The simplest thing is go to a place where the temperature is already low. So the on Earth, the coldest place ever recorded is about 180 Kelvin, that is around minus 93 degrees Celsius in Antarctica, some part of Antarctica. But it is not in the cryogenic range because our cryogenic range is about 123, highly above that. So there is no place in the Earth where the temperatures are available for us to do the experiment or the liquefaction of gas. Now we go to the another extreme of temperature in the outer space. At 2.7K is an average temperature at the cosmic background temperature. Of course, this is the average temperature. We go to the planet, the temperature may shoot up to many billion. So that also this is an average temperature, of course, which is well within the cryogenics range. But the problem is that taking the experiment or taking the gas requires, it's not economically feasible. So this option of going to the space to have the liquid cryogenic temperature is not economically viable and also operational cost point of view. So both the Earth and space has no
provision for us to go for higher low temperature. We have to look for some process or the techniques to achieve the low temperature. So there are so many processes are there, but these a common four process in which we can produce cryogenic temperature. Okay, so the first one is about heat conduction, evaporative cooling, cooling by rapid expansion, and fourth one is adiabatic demagnetization. Of course, the first two, heat conduction and evaporative cooling, are very generic. You must have heard about this thing. But the third one is also not so common, but it is commonly available in the many of the applications, like, you know, air conditioner, room air conditioner, split air conditioner, freezer, everything. So rapid expansion process there. And fourth one is adiabatic demagnetization, which is a very special process. For example, the first three process, you can start from room temperature and achieve the cryogenic temperature. Whereas this adiabatic demagnetization, it cannot start with room temperature. It has to be start with some minimal cryogenic temperature. It can go only further. So this process is special. So it start with the cryogenic temperature and can go further. So basically, these are the four processes which we are going to see that how using this process, how a low temperature or the cryogenic temperature used in terms of. So our objective or the focus is understanding the process and the final application in the terms of commercial or the large scale application. So when you do for something on the laboratory scale, we are not worried. We are worried about the cycle is used on a commercial large quantity production. So in that way, we are going to see at the final application point of view. Now the first part, conduction, we know that it means that there is a cold surface already available. And we are only cooling, like, you know, you have a refrigerator, the cycle, Freon cycle is working at the back, which produce low temperature. You are only cooling the samples or your food or whatever the thing. So you have the cryo surface or the cold surface available in which you cool it. So in technically, we in the cryogenics, we call as a cold finger, because there is a surface available which has cryogenic temperature so that we can attach the sample, we can do experiment. Or in other way, you have the cryogenic surface available, which is very cold, and gas comes in contact, get condensed, frozen, or cooled, depend upon the temperature and the types of gas it is available. Okay, so it, because of this conduction process by which you can have achieve the cryogenic temperature, but in the sense that there is some cryo surface or cryo refrigerator working at the back end to produce this low temperature. The next one is about the cooling by evaporation. We know that evaporation of liquid produce cooling, the latent heat of evaporation. Normally, when you have a liquid, all these processes when we are going to mention is all happening in an isolated environment. And thermodynamically, we have understand that thermally isolated environment where there no energy, mass, everything from the atmosphere come in contact to the system. Okay. So all our process, what we are going to describe is thermally isolated thing. So when you have a liquid, when it gets evaporated, it needs energy from going from liquid phase to gaseous phase. So the energy from the, or from the low energy level to higher energy level, it needs some energy. So the energy is taken from the liquid itself. So the, when the molecules goes from the liquid phase to gaseous phase, it takes the energy from the liquid, remaining liquid inside, and it goes to the higher phase. So this process, since that conservation of energy has to be maintained, as it is the thermally isolated environment, the liquid temperature goes down. Okay, so by which the process of evaporation, due to the latent heat of evaporation, there will be a continuous production of low temperature is possible at the cost of the gas evaporation. So this process is used in cryogenics to reduce the temperature of liquid by constantly pumping away. So we will see in further slides how this can be useful. Oh, however, the Michael Faraday, we know for the magnetism and nothing, but in fact, he's a father of cryogenics. And in, he was the first person who has done various experiments to ready to try to liquefy all the gases. So in 1845, he tried to achieve, of course, it is not in liquid cryogenic temperature range, he achieved about 163 Kelvin by evaporating the low pressure mixture. So what he used is as a mixture of solid carbon dioxide and ether. And one side he increased the pressure, other side he reduced the temperature. At some point of time, that the sealed tube where it get evaporated, just you remove the sealing and it suddenly evaporate in the atmosphere, and that produce cooling. So by which he has produced the very low temperature of thing. Of course, liquid air, liquid nitrogen can also be done, but our objective is to do have a constant large scale production. This method is only a momentary thing which is not usable. So of course, as a process, he has started by evaporation, by which he has achieved a low temperature. When this was happening, similarly, many people thought that by raising the pressure, we can liquefy the gas. So many gases like ammonia, nitrogen oxide, sulfur dioxide, CO2, when you reduce, increase the pressure to more than atmospheric pressure, it starts liquefying. We know that liquefied petroleum gas is in gaseous form. When you increase the pressure to 4 to 4.5 bar, then it becomes liquid. Like in the same in the refrigerator, we have a R22 or a freon gas hydrofluoric compound. When it compressed to about 3 bar and becomes liquid, and you have the condenser. Okay. So by increasing the pressure, you can liquefy many gases, but not all the gases. So in fact, when this was done, nitrogen, oxygen, hydrogen, at very old time, even the helium was not even discovered. So these gases were unable to liquefy by increasing the pressure. People have gone even to for the 1,000 atmosphere, 3,000 atmosphere. So it is still they could not able to liquefy the gases just by compressing this thing. Okay, so we have to go for other process. What you use an expansion process or the rapid expansion process to liquefy gases which were not done by this process of simply increasing the pressure. So here it is a kind of an isentropic expansion. Isenthalpic expansion. A high pressure gas is allowed to pass through a porous plug or a needle wall or something. So gas is something allowed to expand. It's kind of a free expansion. It does not remove any energy from the gas. It just makes the molecules move apart. Okay, that try to enter the intermolecular forces, interatomic forces which were holding together was removed and that was started moving. So this process of isenthalpic process, which is also called as a Joule-Thomson process or your throttling process or throttle wall, JT wall, all comes under the same category of isenthalpic expansion, which produces cooling. And this process is irreversible. You know, in thermodynamics, we know that any process which is irreversible is very energy inefficient. So if you want to have an efficient process, it should have been a reversible process. But this process is irreversible. So it is a very inefficient process, but it can produce cooling. So using this process, many gas, including the hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, were liquefied using the Joule-Thomson wall. But as I told you, we wanted to go on a large commercial scale production, like, you know, plant where you can give some fuel, 150 liter, 20 liter, 10 liter per hour, kind of a constant production. In that sense, Linde is the first one who used this concept of Joule-Thomson expansion to produce liquid air, liquid nitrogen, liquid oxygen in a large commercial scale. Okay, so the process is something similar. You have the gas which gets compressed, pass through the heat exchanger, and then walk through the Joule-Thomson wall. And what is after Joule-Thomson, that whatever the liquid vapor mixture, the liquid gets collected here, and the cold low pressure vapor moves in the reverse direction through the heat exchanger, cooling the incoming hot high pressure gas. And when it comes out of the thing, the heat exchanger, it goes into the compressor section, where it get mixed with the makeup gas to compensate the cycle mass, whatever the quantity you have liquefied. So this is the simplest cycle by which all gases can be liquefied, even though practical commercial people in a commercial cycle do not use as such. We use something different. We'll see in quite different technique. Of course, this process remains the same. However, doing this process of simple Joule-Thomson expansion, when we are trying with hydrogen and helium, instead of high pressure gas expanded in the Joule-Thomson wall, instead of reduction in temperature, the temperature was going up. The temperature was increased upon Joule-Thomson expansion for the gas like hydrogen and helium. So people were not understand that the simple Joule-Thomson expansion, we cannot. So people thought these are all real gases, we can't liquefy it. Okay, ideal gas, we can't liquefy it. So this problem was taken up. The difficulties in liquefaction of hydrogen and helium was taken up by Van der Waal. So we know that all the gases available here, we are considered as an ideal gas. Typically, ideal gas means you can never liquefy the ideal gas. So that is, we are liquefying all the gas. So there is some non-idealness or non-ideal behavior make the gas liquefy. So what do you call as a real gases? If you see that PV is equal to NRT, that's a isolated law. These all laws are based on certain assumption. So these ideal gas assumption, like, you know, Boyle's law, Charles' law, Avogadro's law, they are all under normal circumstances assumed under the assumption that they are all ideal gases. But none of the gas is ideal gas. Everything is a real. You know that all the gas now known to us are been liquefied. So none of the gas is ideal gas. If in that sense, all these formula which are used for ideal gas can never be utilized now. Like, you know, Boyle's law, Charles' law, nothing can be used. But we still use in all our regular calculation and application. Yes, we can use these laws under certain condition. What are the condition is that if the temperature of the gas is not so close to the liquefaction temperature or the pressure is not about 20 times the atmospheric pressure. If the two conditions are there, you can comfortably make. If it is exceed, you have to put some factors. So that is what Van der Waals was thinking. There is some opposite behavior makes it not to liquefy was realized by Van der Waals by this calculation. So before going into that slide, I just wanted to mention. So Boyle's law, we know PV is equal to constant. So when you have a graph of PV versus P, you get a straight line. And we know Charles' law, V by T is a constant as the volume temperature reduces, volume reduces. Now we have seen that how absolute temperature was clearly very specifically, very precisely measured. And we know that this is not practically achievable. So it is with a very, very simple extrapolation which was done by Kelvin, M. Kelvin. So he what he did that he just extrapolated the Charles' law, V by T, to further down, and he was seeing that where it was seeing at the hitting at the temperature scale. So at this day, that volume becomes zero. The absolute zero is 273.15. Now the reason, very in a very simple or a crude or raw way, that why this temperature cannot be achieved theoretically as well practically possible is simple. The reason that as it goes down, what we are seeing is that volume is getting reduced as we go down and down the temperature. At this temperature, we are seeing that the volume is zero. So when you are cooling a gas, you have to account for at least the molar volume of the gas. You can't neglect that. So here that everything is vanished. It is not possible. So this theoretical limit of the lower temperature of 273.1 is only a theoretical limit, I think. And it also says that as it goes lower and low, it is not the gas. Is many molecules here. We are going for a few atoms to cool it. As we are going for a very low temperature, it is not the bulk gas liquid cooled or liquefied or condensed. It is very few atoms because the molar volume itself is become a huge heat load at that point of time. So we will see in some of the slides. Now, coming back to the difficulties in liquefaction, the Van der Waals, he thought that the pressure PV is equal to RT should be modified, making the factor that number of mole and molar volume using the constant. So intermolecular forces comes into the picture when you increase the pressure more than 20 bar, that has to be accounted in the pressure term. And the same time, the volume, the molar volume has to be reduced from the volume scale by the number of moles. So he added a constant of A and B, what is called the Van der Waals constant to the thing, which is also called the Van der Waals value attractive or repulsive force. So when the gas expands from the Joule-Thomson expansion, the temperature may reduce or go up, depend upon the predominance of these Van der Waals forces A and B. There is a particular point, what is called the critical temperature point, where when your gas is expanded from high pressure to low pressure in the Joule-Thomson valve, there is no change in the temperature between the before expansion and after expansion. So that is called the critical temperature. So when you find that what is the critical temperature or the maximum inversion or the maximum critical temperature or inversion temperature or the temperature at which there is no change, then we give an idea that how we can go about it. So if this graph was given, this is the area of the temperature, there is no change in the thing. So if we have the maximum critical temperature of the gas is less than the critical temperature, the temperature is less than critical temperature, then when the increase, the temperature will decrease upon expansion. Or if you cool the gas below that inversion temperature and when you do the Joule-Thomson expansion, there will be a reduction in temperature. If it is above, and you will see increase in temperature. So this was founded by various gases, the critical temperature. For example, the hydrogen is 202 Kelvin and helium is 43 Kelvin. Why people could not understand this problem? Because all these other gases were already higher than the atmospheric pressure, atmospheric temperature. So people could not visualize this problem. For example, if you have the air, if you increase the temperature to 700K and then try to Joule-Thomson, it will not going to reduce the temperature. It will in fact go from above 603 Kelvin. So this where we know that we need to cool the gas prior to Joule Thomson gas if you want to further reduction in temperature. So this information was crucial to go about further in liquefying the gas of hydrogen and helium. So with this information, James Thibar, he cooled the gas below its critical temperature of 202 and liquefied hydrogen mixing. Okay, so basically at that point of time, all the liquefaction cycles were based on the cascade cooling. It is not the simple thing. You had many levels of cooling. So start from methyl chloride, methane, oxygen, air, and then finally hydrogen. So the multiple cascade cooling, each will be cooling the various stages by which you attain. So it is very, very difficult process, because any of the process had a problem, it will affect all the further thing down. So it's very difficult to achieve. So by that, with that process, only people liquefied, and James, you were the one who liquefied hydrogen in 1898. In fact, we know that with his contribution in invention of thermos flask, he has one who has developed a vacuum jacketed vessel, which is one with the thing. In fact, he has developed the thermos flask, and he sold that patent to a company called Thermos. So thermos flask is not his invention, it's from James Thibar. So all the cryogenic container, we call it as Thibar, cryogenic Thibar. Okay, so he is the one who developed the Thibar also, without which you can't imagine the liquefaction or preservation of hydrogen and helium and thing. So again, with the same fundamental, 1908, Kamerling Wundt liquefied using cascade cooling, using Joule Thomson cooling the helium gas before its below its inversion temperature of 43 Kelvin using liquid hydrogen as a pre-cooling, because liquid hydrogen is at 20 Kelvin, that is used to cool the gas so that it falls below the liquefaction critical temperature, and he liquefied that. Again, it's a cascade cooling where it's one more cycle is added to helium is hydrogen is also. So he started with liquid air, liquid oxygen, liquid helium. So there are complex process were there to liquefy the gases in the time. So it was a major breakthrough at that point of time. So we had very few quantity of gases. In fact, the initial gas was taken from a monazite sand from Kerala, and using the nuclear reaction process, heating process, we got the gas. You know, we got input very, very small amount of gas by which he could able to liquefy, and also discovered the superconductivity. Okay, now we have seen this process of cascade cooling, Joule Thomson expansion or isenthalpic expansion can liquefy all the gases. However, when you go for a commercial and energy efficient system, these are all not energy efficient and also very operationally in difficult process. So we have to go for another expansion called adiabatic expansion. Here, the high pressure gas is allowed to do some work, or you are extracting the energy from the gas, from the heat energy is removed in the form of work. So as I, again, it is in a thermal isolated environment. When you take the energy to compensate the energy, the gas temperature has to cool down. And this is called an isentropic process or a heat energy process. It's a reversible process. You can again put the work back, compress the gas, go back to all the thing, and you can again go to normal state. So this reversible process is very, very efficient, as in the thermodynamically reversible process are highly energy efficient. So the high pressure gas basically will be pushing a piston or rotating a turbine by which you can produce low temperature. The basic refrigeration of adiabatic expansion happening by extracting the work through a piston or expansion. It's a very most efficient cycle. Now, just a comparison between both the isenthalpic expansion and adiabatic expansion is that when you have a gas cooled from expanded in a Joule Thomson valve from 40 bar to 1 bar in a Joule Thomson cooling, you produce a delta T or a temperature drop of 10 degree. Whereas in adiabatic cooling, the same process 40 bar to 1 bar will give an refrigeration of close to 125 degree Celsius. There's a huge refrigeration produced for the same condition. So adiabatic expansion gives maximum efficiency, and Joule Thomson gives a very poor efficiency. But so the next cycle for going for the commercial one is what developed by the Linde, modification of Linde by the Claude cycle. What he has done, he has modified the Linde cycle by adding an expansion process in between the Joule Thomson valve. So there is a combination of Joule Thomson expansion and isentropic expansion. Both were combined. Now we can question that why, when this expansion process gives a huge benefit. Why you need this? Because you need this one, because all this gas, when you are doing any rotating component, cannot handle two-phase mixture. It's very difficult, because when the gas enters and gaseous form, the process, the fluid enters in a gaseous form, and during the end of the process or during the process, it becomes liquid, because there is a huge volume ratio reduction happen. So we call it the mechanical shock happens to the rotating component. That is the reason that single this process, isentropic expansion, cannot handle two-phase mixture. So you produce maximum refrigeration here, and you only do the phase change in the Joule-Thomson valve, which takes care of all the things. Here there is no moving component. So the combination of this isentropic and isenthalpic process can comfortably give you liquid vapor mixture in a highly energy efficient manner. So with this, all the gases of including hydrogen and helium were liquefied. And of course, when you go for a practical commercial thing, it is a bit different, because instead of one expansion turbine, we go for two. In fact, they can go for three, four, five, depend upon the requirement also thing. So this call is a Claude cycle. Basically, Claude is an engineer who developed the heat exchanger and tried to utilize two expansion engine. In fact, it's also called the Linde-Hampson cycle or modified Claude cycle. So there are different names are there, depend upon the modification. All said and done comes from Linde, and Claude cycle is a basic fundamental. So here, basically, it's a three a stage of expansion, 3 days of refrigeration. First stage expansion from room temperature to 80 Kelvin. Second stage expansion in the expander, but from 80 Kelvin to 20 Kelvin. And final Joule-Thomson expansion in the third stage, we go to produce 4.2 Kelvin. So this is a process which by which you can have liquefaction in a commercial scale. So that, but first commercial plant was used on this ADL Collins. In fact, it was manufactured by Collins himself thing. So you have they use the piston expansion thing. So when you have the piston expansion, you can't have a large liquefaction rate. When you increase the production capacity, you have to increase the piston. So bore size has to be go up. If you see here, this is the piston is about 0.7 meter long. And it's a very special material, because one end at room temperature, other end is very cold temperature. So you can't, you have a limitation of going into the higher production rate with this piston type of expansion. So we need to go for the next one, which is a turbine expansion. In principle, the turbine which produces, instead of piston, the isentropic expansion using piston is replaced by isentropic expansion with turbine. This in principle have almost infinite to this capacity as such. Now you can go for any large capacity by adding number of turbines more. In fact, the efficiency of the turbine expansion efficiency is very high, to close to 94, because nowadays the turbine can handle high mass flow rate and high pressure ratio, which is possible. So by which you can have a large efficiency, a large liquefaction rate where possible using this commercial expansion engine using turbine, turbo expansion. So the turbo expander, which is delicate and highly expensive component, and it's a high pressure gas is rotating the turbine. And the speciality is that the turbine rotates at 2.5 lakhs RPM. 2.5 lakhs RPM, you imagine, in fact, there are turbine which can go up to 5 lakhs also. So at this speed, maintaining the speed, measuring the speed, controlling that shaft, bearing of the shaft, everything is highly challenging. So there is a very, very difficult in terms of all these technologies involved. So by this, all the gas, in fact, we do have a plant which has a turbine-based liquefaction. So with this, all these techniques, we can comfortably have liquid helium at 4.2 K, but life doesn't stop with that. We need as low as possible. How do we go further below 4.2 K? So these are the two processes which we'll quickly explain. Okay, now another 20 minutes. Okay. Reducing the vapor. First one is reducing the vapor pressure. We have seen the latent heat of vaporization, the first part by which we can go down below 4.2 K. The next one is the dilution refrigerator, by which you can go to millikelvin. And then fourth process, whatever mentioned earlier, is an adiabatic demagnetization process, which also go up to millikelvin. And then next one is a nuclear demagnetization, which can go up to microkelvin. And of course, absolute zero. Now, I stopped here at microkelvin and absolute zero, whereas you can even go further down also. Why I stopped here, in the sense that, as I told you, whatever the temperature we have produced, the temperature should be usable for our experiment. In that sense, microkelvin is the limit by which you can do. You can't have the experiment possible below that, because remaining going below is only for the sake of going below, not for the application point of view. In that sense, micro Kelvin is the area where we stop that we can have further. Of course, we have so many other things. People have gone to pico Kelvin, 10 to the power 12. But at this thing, there are few atoms of rhodium were cooled using this nuclear demagnetization. We will go. So here, only few atoms were cooled to go below that. So people have achieved up to that much, 10 to the power minus 12 Kelvin, which we know that we can't go further down or as such now. We can't go to absolute zero. Okay. Now coming back to the first part, pumping on liquid helium to reduce the temperature, is that, as I told you, that enthalpy, you have to take a number of moles from liquid enthalpy to vapor. It needs some energy. That energy is nothing but the latent heat of evaporation. That you can, by which you can have a low temperature is possible. So basically, the molecule cross the boundary of liquid phase to gaseous phase, taking the energy from the liquid itself. But if you have the liquid nitrogen, we can go up to 65 Kelvin, by which the nitrogen freezes. Liquid hydrogen, we can go up to 14 Kelvin. And if we have liquid helium, a 4.2 K, if we can go up to 0.8 Kelvin, of course, there are some, helium is a very special fluid. There are so many other process takes place which doesn't allow us to go below that. And I wanted to mention about another thing. Helium has two components. The helium 3, which is helium 4, is a stable element, and helium 3 is an isotope of helium. So both the helium 3 and helium 4 are available. Normally, when you say helium, it is assumed that's helium 4. Unless if it is a helium 3, you have to specifically mention helium 3. Wherever when they mention helium, it is assumed helium 4. So with the helium 4, you can go up to 0.8 K. And we also have a gas of helium 3. Again, you liquefy with the helium liquid and then pump on helium 3, you go further down. Okay. So this is how we can go up to low temperature by evaporation process. Now, the second question is about the dilution refrigerator. The dilution refrigerator is just like a normal helium, but instead of helium 3, in helium 4, it mixture of helium 3 and helium 4. So that fluid as such as a homogeneous gas mixture is cooled with the liquid helium or 0.8 K after reducing the temperature. The gas temperature, the helium 3, helium 4 mixture as such liquefies. Okay, so the property of this mixture is such that when the temperature go, when you are pumping on the helium 3, helium 4 mixture, when the temperature reaches about 0.86 Kelvin, the property of this mixture is something like that. Suddenly, the helium 3, helium 4, helium homogeneous mixture suddenly started behaving like, you know, oil and water. So helium 3 suddenly separates out from the helium 4 mixture. So both become separate. So this process of separation happening at that temperature is something equivalent to isentropic expansion. Okay. So that expansion process, reduction to cooling. So when you have the helium 3, helium 4 mixture is reduced or pumping on that thing, when it happens at the 4.2, the 0.86, the separation takes place, the liquid helium 3 mixture temperature goes to millikelvin. So by this process, you can go for millikelvin application. So by pumping on continuous basis of helium 3 pumping, and we can continuously achieve a temperature of millikelvin. Of course, there's a setup actual experiment by which you can have a temperature of millikelvin possible. I'm not going into detail of it. And now I'm coming to the adiabatic demagnetization, which is the next process. Here, there is a paramagnetic material. You know that, you know, we have a material which is normal. The paramagnetic material is like a magnet, but the magnetic moments are randomly aligned. You know, with the normal magnet, we know South Pole and North Pole are very precisely there, so it acts like a magnet. So you assume a magnet, all the North and South Poles are randomly aligned, so the net magnetic field is zero. So this paramagnetic material is something like that, that magnetic moments are randomly aligned. So when you have the salt, you cool it with liquid helium or 0.8 K, reducing the vapor pressure. And when you apply an external magnetic field to the salt, at 0.8 K or 1.8 K, whatever the thing, when you apply an external magnetic field, the randomly aligned magnetic moments aligns and behaves like a perfect magnet in a magnetic field. So this process of aligning itself will increase, it's something like an isothermal compression. So the compression leads to increase in temperature. Since the whole atmosphere in liquid helium or for 1.8 K, with the magnetic field on, with the magnetic moments are aligned, you cool back the salt to further down so that the temperature is far below the same condition what it was earlier with the magnetic moment on. So at this moment you remove the magnetic field. When the magnetic moment, the magnet is removed or demagnetized, the salt, it comes straight to comes back to the previous non-aligned state. So that is something equivalent to expansion of gas. Okay, so that salt during the demagnetization process produced low temperature to close to millikelvin range. So you start with the millikelvin. So you to start to have that thing, the adiabatic demagnetization, you need a cryogenic temperature of 4.2 or further below to have this millikelvin possible. So with this thing is again a reversible process. At some point of time, it's heated up after doing the experiment. Again, you cool it, magnetize, cool it, demagnetize it, again you get it. So basically it's like a kind of a batch process. You produce some refrigeration, the refrigeration depend upon the capacity of the pill, you can go up to 4 to 12 hours depend upon the heat load you attach, but you can do. So whereas the liquid dilution refrigerator is a continuous product, here it is a kind of a batch, you know, you have a cooling available a few hours. So there are some salt like, you know, potash, alum, cerium, manganese, nitrate, we can go up to millikelvin when you apply a very high magnetic field. Okay, this is one process which we have taken. Similarly, for going below millikelvin to microkelvin, what we do is exactly like adiabatic demagnetization, but it is in nuclear level, nuclear demagnetization. That's similar to adiabatic demagnetization, except the demagnetization uses a nuclear spin instead of the electron spin of the previous case. The cooling is arised from the alignment of nuclear dipole. So there are the nuclear dipole which are randomly aligned in an atom when it comes in a refrigerant atom. When it comes in contact with the magnetic field, gets aligned, then you remove the magnetic field, go back to normal port. This process leads to cooling of each nucleus of the material. So when you do that, the whole atom gets and the whole solid component gets heated up. Sorry, the refrigeration takes place and you achieve the low temperature. Since that nuclear spinning, nuclear dipoles needs very low temperature, so it has to be backed with the millikelvin. So you need to cool the material in the millikelvin stage, then you apply for nuclear demagnetization. Then you can go to microkelvin. So for if you want to have a microkelvin, you start with liquid helium and you have a DRS system, dilution refrigerator, adiabatic mechanism, produce millikelvin, cool that material with the millikelvin range, then you go for nuclear demagnetization, like a cascade cooling kind of thing. So by which very low temperatures are possible, here, and we do have a setup at TIFR which is recorded at 36 micron. Only it was only one in India, I think, as of now. It can go up to 36 microkelvin, and the microkelvin temperature usable for doing experiment, which is a large system. You have this thing, and in fact, very few systems are there in the world. To my knowledge, I was told about 10 to 12 such systems are there in the world. So very few systems are here, so which can produce low temperature of microkelvin range. So with this background, we have seen from a room temperature to 4.2K and further down to millikelvin and microkelvin, and of course in the absolute zero we are not worried about, because we our experiment wise we stopped at the microkelvin. Further down needs much more cooling, which is not in terms of experimental point of view, it's only in the point of quantum level thing. So with that thing, we just keep to a cryogenic application, because the application of cryogenics, we have seen that the common applications are quite high and very interesting. So we like to see what are the application of cryogenics. So before that, I was told that you also need some share some information about this oxygen separation and process, which is a need of the time. So just to give an idea, so people must have seen that how do you separate oxygen or nitrogen from air. Of course, we do have a system which separates nitrogen gas, and then we liquefy the nitrogen from the atmospheric air. So these are by three techniques you can produce oxygen. You can separate gas from the atmospheric air. One is about the cryogenic distillation, and then other one is pressure swing adsorption system, or you must have heard about so many PSA system, and third one is in membrane basically. So basically cryogenic distillation column, where you have a liquid like a crude oil distillation based on the boiling point. When you have a liquid air and then pass through a fractional column, depend upon the various boiling point, you can withdraw the gas. You know, if it is a 90 Kelvin, pull out oxygen, further down 77 K, you pull out then, and the lower end carbon dioxide can be removed. So by that, you can, in fact, argon, xenon, krypton, all are removed in the cryogenic distillation column. Whereas in PSA, it is only for separation of nitrogen and oxygen. Further, the further down gases like argon, krypton cannot be possible with the PSA system. It has to be done only with the cryogenic distillation process. So as far as the air distillation, air separation is concerned, if your objective is with respect to nitrogen and oxygen, we have many processes are available. When you go for the very further gases of argon, neon, krypton, xenon, you have to lie only on the cryogenic distillation column. Now coming to the pressure swing adsorption system. The pressure swing adsorption, basically it's filled with a kind of an adsorbent material, which are very specific to the gas what you want to separate. For example, for the nitrogen separation, we have a nitrogen, we want to have a separate nitrogen gas from the atmospheric air for our liquefaction, we use carbon molecular sieve. The carbon molecular sieve, if you go to the microstructure of the molecular sieve, it is something like that. The porosity, the mouth is something which will allow only oxygen to enter it. Nitrogen is a bigger in size, so it cannot enter. So all, when you pass through the air, through this material, only oxygen enters through the porosity of the structure, microstructure of this material, and nitrogen cannot enter here. So all the oxygen get trapped in the adsorbent material. At some point of time, the whole material is saturated with oxygen, and we have to regenerate it. So this pressure swing adsorption system, basically there are two systems. One will be purifying and other will be regenerating. Whatever the oxygen trapped in the previous cycle will be thrown out here by using the nitrogen, whatever you have separated here. So all the thing will push out and all the nitrogen and oxygen will throw out into atmosphere. So the nitrogen separation as carbon molecular sieve, which traps the nitrogen, oxygen, and only separates nitrogen by which you can separate the nitrogen gas. Whereas the current oxygen, you have seen that which you use the zeolite based PSA, remaining thing is same. The zeolite structure is something different, that it allow all the bigger molecule to pass through except the oxygen gets trapped in this intermolecular gap. Okay, so by which you remove all the other high carbon gases are there, only left out would be the argon and oxygen. So by which you can give up to 93% to 95% pure of atmospheric air and oxygen from this system. Of course, we also, as I was mentioning about the distillation column, you have to have a liquid air and then separates in a column like what we do in the crude oil distillation. And what we did in TIFR recently with the requirement for nitrogen, we are also trying to make an attempt to remove exhaust gas, the oxygen rich exhaust gas from the previous the PSA system of the nitrogen plant, try to purify in a cryogenic purification column by which you can try to remove the oxygen purity. So we have achieved close to 93% of liquid oxygen, but the medical grade need higher, more. We are on that process of purifying further down to 99.7%, which was achieved in 2-3 cases, but we are streamlining the operation so that we can have a continuous production or assured purity of 99 plus on all the time, and all the production rate, and then how do we. So this currently we are working on that thing without affecting the liquid nitrogen production. So this part of the thing. Okay, now coming back to the application point, I mentioned that there are properties like superconductivity and superfluidity happens only in cryogenic temperature. So when you reduce the temperature, when you cool a material with a low temperature or the cryogenic temperature, the electrical resistance keeps coming down. So in a superconductor, at a particular temperature, what you call a critical temperature, the resistance jumps down to zero. It is not gradually going. It suddenly drops to zero. So the electrical resistance jumps down to zero, occurs at certain temperature of a material. We call it as a critical temperature for that material. For example, initially when Kamerling owns liquefied helium at 4.2K, he used mercury and he found the resistance was going to zero. So he discovered the superconductivity with mercury at that time, which was very close to liquid helium temperature. And if you see that other materials, zinc, aluminium, tin, they are all very low temperature. And the current quest on the research is to make a material which becomes superconductor without need of any cryogenic temperature, even at room temperature should have. So what you call the high temperature superconductor, which does not need much cooling. So for the research, even so-called high temperature superconductor, which still requires liquid nitrogen. So we have a yttrium barium copper oxide compound, which is a ceramic compound by which you can go with the transition temperature in 90 Kelvin. So if you have a nitrogen, liquid nitrogen of 77 Kelvin, you cool and become superconductor. Of course, we want to have all the materials, metals should have a superconductor so that the malleability and ductility is there by which you can make a magnet or you make a coil, you can make a motor, all those things. So that this, if you hear the metal component, the niobium, which niobium, titanium, niobium tin, they are all very famous metal. The transition temperature is close to 9 to 10 Kelvin. It means it needs liquid helium to cool the material to make it superconductor. So it is very widely used for the making the large magnet. For example, if you are making a magnet in a traditional way, if you want to make a 1 Tesla, that is 10,000 gauss capacity of the magnet, the size of the magnet in a traditional way would be something like, you know, one bedroom big size, and the weight of the magnet would be around 1 ton. Okay, whereas if you have the instead of this normal copper coil, if you go for a niobium titanium and you make the magnet of 1 Tesla, which is cooled with liquid helium, then the size of the magnet will be like 700 grams and I can keep my in my palm. So the huge size reduction is possible only with superconducting material or superconducting magnet. In case if you want to go nothing, you know, I don't mind about the weight and space, even then you cannot build your normal super magnet more than two or three Tesla, because it doesn't allow to get. So higher magnet is possible only with superconducting material using cryogenics. So that is how the superconducting. And of course, the superconductor also passes through many effect called the Meissner effect, which is widely used for the levitation trains. When you have a conductor, it is a normal board. When it's subjected to a magnetic field, the magnetic field pierces through the material. But when you cool the material and because the material becomes superconductor, and so-called the magnetic field which are piercing, now it starts rippling. So it acts like a magnet. So the normal conductor, which was at room temperature, normal conductor, and when it's exposed to make a superconductor, it behaves like a magnet and repels the magnetic field. So that magnet to magnet repulsive force happening, which makes to levitate. That's how that levitation trains are there. And this is an yttrium barium copper oxide. The transition is 90 Kelvin. So I have a small video. This is the yttrium barium copper oxide. When it's subjected to a permanent magnet, when it's cooled with liquid nitrogen, it starts floating. In fact, it is not even floating, it's also attracting. That's called a pinning effect takes place, which it also doesn't allow to go out of the conductor. It does not ripple too much. It's also started floating when it becomes superconductor, and there is a pinning effect there. So it also it's also attracting. It does not attract, it cannot reduce the gap. It float as well as attract. So kind of a pinning effect happened. Because of that, we can have this many of these levitation train possible. Now about the super fluidity, there is a very specific happening with the liquid helium. When you reduce the temperature of 4.2 Kelvin liquid helium using an evaporation process, when the temperature is keep coming down due to the latent heat of evaporation, when the temperature comes to 2.176, 2.2K, the liquid helium become a superfluid. Superfluid means that it does not have any viscosity. Viscosity becomes zero and it can climb against gravity. Okay, it can pierce through the intermolecular spaces and comes out of the vessel also. So this is because of that going below 2.2K is much difficult with because of this process. And that specific heat capacity is shooting up very high, and we call it as this point is called the lambda point, as because in we plot the heat capacity with the temperature, it looks like a Greek letter lambda. So this point of 2.16 is called the lambda point of at which liquid helium becomes superfluid. And again about the further thing and the particle acceleration. So we use cryogenics in form of making a cryogenic superconducting magnet. For example, the CERN Large Hadron Collider, which uses large magnets to bend the electrical beam, proton beam, and that needs to be cooled with liquid helium. and which is goes to close to 1.8 Kelvin, so that you further cool and can produce high magnetic field about close to 8 Tesla thing. So in TFR, we do have a superconducting LINAC booster to accelerate the particles using the superconducting cavities. The cavity itself is cooled to liquid helium temperature. It becomes superconductor by which you can have the accelerate the particle to very high energy, And the very famous example or where you are been interested in that is that MRI, magnetic resonant imaging, MRI imaging, MRI scanning. So the MRI scanning needs a large magnetic field of 4 to 7 Tesla also possible. A typical MRI scan which has about 4 Tesla. To make the 4 Tesla using the niobium titanium material cooled with liquid helium, that comes the cryogenics into the part. Okay. Now, this is very similar to the operation of that MRI scan. I try to put in this technique, the magnetic field is impinged into our body where the hydrogen atoms in the, our body, because from the water component, which emits certain frequency when we are impacted to high magnetic field. So the emitted frequency from the hydrogen hydrogen component from the body is captured and analyzed in form of two-dimensional, three-dimensional way. So there's a, each hydrogen nucleus has one proton, maybe a spin up or spin, it's a randomly aligned. Okay, when you increase the, it's a randomly aligned hydrogen proton in the hydrogen nucleus, is that, and when you subject to magnetic high magnetic field, when it's impinged to magnetic field, it gets aligned like the way we have seen it. So when it gets aligned, at that time there is a very polarized radio field or the tuned frequency is fed into that system, and whatever the aligned gain, the because of the frequency, it slightly flips down. So the flips down and try to come back after when you remove the frequency, try to come back to after certain time. So when it comes back, it induces certain frequency out. That frequency is very the NMR phenomenon can be detected by a receiving coil, and that information is studied in a two-dimensional, three-dimensional way by which you can have a imaging is possible to have it. And the next one is about the space cryogenics, which is a very I have another 5 minutes I will close. And space cryogenic, where there is a large component of fuel and oxidation is burnt in a cryogenic temperature, it has been taken. Here we have a fuel as liquid hydrogen, which is at 20 Kelvin, and we have an oxygen atmosphere to have a burning with this liquid oxygen at 90 Kelvin. Both are taken in very high pressure, that's about 5 megapascal, and both are liquid form and get evaporated and then combust in a combustion chamber so that you get an enough thrust. So typically, NASA like or a SpaceX equivalent will burn about 20 lakhs liters of liquid hydrogen and oxygen to have a first stage of think about 7 seconds, 8 minutes is a, what you call as a full duration of 8 minutes is possible with this kind of a fuel. So we need to have a large quantity of fuel and oxidation to have the large weight taken to the as a payload is very high possible. Whereas in India, we do started in 1982 with the Russian collaboration, but later Russian backed out and we have to develop our own cryogenic engine. The whole problem is that it's how to assure a complete gaseous form at the entry of combustion chamber. So in a combustion chamber, it should have absolute gaseous form, no droplets or no proper thing. So the enough quantity of at enough mass and enough quantity at enough pressure of gas coming into the combustion ignition chamber is very essential. That is very, very problem. That was an initial setback we had it. So we had many failures. Of course, the first flight happened in 2014. Of course, India, unlike NASA and SpaceX, we are not using cryogenic at the first stage. We are very well, okay with the solid fuel at the ground stage one. We are going for the second stage and third stage, we go for a cryogenic thing. Whereas NASA, all the stage, we have a cryogenic. But in addition to that, they also have a solid booster. In addition to have a maximum booster is possible. So there are many. The recent one was in 2017 using the cryogenic second stage was successfully happened. So this was on the space cryogenic, and a large applications are happening in a cryosurgery. So what you call the cryotherapy or the cryoablation, which is a process of destroying our tissue, damage a problematic tissue without any surgery. It's kind of an endoscopy based, is something equivalent to bloodless surgery. The component is cooled, or whatever the tumor or the part which you wanted to remove is just cooled with liquid nitrogen. In fact, it is not liquid nitrogen, the liquid nitrogen probe, so that you just by conduction you just cool the organ, and then once it becomes repeated cooling and heating make that particular component die, and then we can cryo. Cryoablation is a process that you can die after repeated heating and cooling, so by which we can remove the con. For example, you have I have a small video about the kidney. The tumor has to be removed. So what they do, the cryo probe is inserted into the tumor, and it goes just below the tumor also. And liquid nitrogen or the cold nitrogen gas is passed to the needle, so that by conduction, the organ, because of this fluid here, get frozen. This is the freezing component. After a certain time of freezing, you allow the cell, the ice to form above the tumor, then you heat it up. The heating can be done by putting the hot gas in the tumor, the needle here, and again you cool it. This time, little bigger crystallization form. The repeated, again heat it. So repeated heating and cooling make this tumor die, and you can cryoablate and can cut off this dead tumor by which you can think. So these kind of a things happening very, very common in the patient. It's called a bloodless surgery. So endoscopy means recovery time is much faster than anything else. And in fact, cosmetic surgery is also using liquid nitrogen probe. Sorry. So here, the kind of some kind of an wart, a freeze of wart, or the kind of extra growth are cooled with this needle, which is cooled with liquid nitrogen, by which the cryotherapy or cryosurgery can be done. So repeated cooling, heating makes that wart can be pulled out. Is there a hammer cooled with liquid nitrogen and slowly dead, and we can remove. So there are many processes are available. Okay. And next one is about the animal husbandry. There is a huge application of nitrogen or the cryogenic used in animal husbandry to preserve these sperms and the cells of the biological samples of so many animals. In fact, there are so many blood storage and stem cell storage are there. You normally they collect the stem cell from along with the blood. They remove the blood and then accumulate, put some antibodies to collect these stem cells, and they are preserved in fluid, and they are stored in liquid nitrogen temperature, are called the cryopreservation of stem cell, and later can be injected whenever we require. So this can be, even these stem cells are connected from bone marrow or with the blood. Okay, so both are possible, that are collected and preserved for later use. So liquid nitrogen is very heavily used in this application. And liquid nitrogen also uses in high temperature superconducting power cabling. We know that the power produced from the source and to the receiving end or the home end, the transit losses is because of the electrical resistance is more than 60%. So if we have the material instead of copper or some other, if you have superconducting material, we are already now 60% surplus of the power what we have now. So, but since it is not happening at the grid level, the cables are wrapped with this ytterbium copper oxide coated on a film, which is wrapped in the with the cable, and it is cooled with liquid nitrogen, so that the maximum resistance at the grid level is reduced using this high temperature superconducting cable, which is using liquid nitrogen. And other area where the nitrogen is used or the cryogen is used is in this windmill. There are massive windmill which are located in a very remote location where it's continuously rotating. There is a wear and tear happens on the bearing. It's very difficult to repair on this thing. So what they do, the bearings are coated with superconducting material, and you have a liquid nitrogen machine which takes atmospheric air, produce nitrogen, and then cool, or even air also, which is get cooled with the thing, and the electric power is available here. So by which the life of the bearing, a superconducting bearing, the life can be extended tremendously, more than 12 times is possible by using this superconducting thing. And about the food preservation, India highly using liquid nitrogen to preserve the prawn and fish, which are exported on a daily basis to various countries. So basically, it just passed through the shower of liquid nitrogen. It is frozen and can be packed immediately. In fact, large herbal leaves, curry leaves, they are all cooled with liquid nitrogen and become brittle. You crush and seal it immediately. Otherwise, a normal thing would have been you dry it on the sun and then crush it. In that process, you lose the texture and flavor of that leaf. So by this process of cooling in liquid nitrogen and packing is much more easier in terms of thing. Okay. Now, a very special area where cryogenic is used in industries is called cryogenic carbon capture. Lot of industrial waste emits CO2, carbon dioxide, from the chimneys. It has an effect on the environmental also. So what they do, the whatever the expulsion gas, that the effluent gas, you pass through the liquid nitrogen temperature, the CO2 in that gas, industrial emission, is condensed or even frozen as a dry ice, and dry ice can be removed by process. So that can be used for industry as a preservation. So a small video, which is a long video, I'll just pause a bit. Okay. So what they do, the gas is flushed through liquid nitrogen temperature. So all the hydrogen carbon dioxide component in the thing is removed. And so this is removed continuously from the thing, and you can the conveyor takes out the carbon dioxide, solid dry ice, and you can make a cake and then use it for the preservation purpose. Okay, the next one is about the cryo machining. In fact, lot of application or the machining operation, that the plant operation which uses liquid cooling fluid, when you do the machining operation, the affected gas is not very harmful for the effluent. The gas comes out of the heating of the tool post, very, very dangerous to the operator. So instead, they are using carbon dioxide as jet as a coolant animal. And in fact, it also helps in the material process. It does not make a local hardening, and you can have a tanning. The tool itself will have a cryogenic nozzles, which is a CO2 or the nitrogen vapor, high pressure vapor is there, by which you can have a very, very comfortable, I think you say you have a tool which is have a built-in port for the carbon dioxide to come out, and you can machine it. So many things are possible. Okay, so this is what I mentioned about the cryo treatment of metal. So when you have all the tools in most of the MNC, a multinational company, telco, Godrej, all these people, they are using the tools which are cryo treated. There's a cryo treatment is just soak the material active portion in liquid nitrogen temperature for about 24 hours and slowly anneal it to the room temperature. So during the process, the material, the wear and tear, what happened in the normal procedure is reduced more than 12 times. The same thing happening in the previous machining also, it does not harm. You know, when you do all the kind of a heating, by adding some small percentage for the cryo treatment, the huge benefit is there. In fact, all the gears, gun barrels, all these sophisticated parts or cannon parts are all treated with liquid nitrogen by the kind of a cryo treated. The other wide area is about the deburring process. But lot of packing element which has a uses plastic component, when you do the die molding, you always have a mold relief will be there. So which is very, very sharp arbitrage will be there. So we have to clean it. When your product is manufactured in lakhs, cleaning is very difficult. So what they do, they put in a dumbling process or the sand, like a sandblasting process within a liquid nitrogen cooled sandblasting operation. So when you do that, when the material become cold, it become brittle, and all the sharp complex, protruding part, and during the dumbling process get broken and you have a nice shape thing. So the deburring can be happening in a dumbling process in a cryogenic environment. And next is the shrink fitting. Normally, when you have the wheel and axis has to be fit, you need to have a close tolerance, and then you apply the high pressure to insert the shaft. Or otherwise is that you can heat the shaft to high temperature and then insert it, which is also possible. But when you heat it, here, and that surface hardness of the material goes very high, and later machining would be a very problem. And you also have the surface structure also changes. Instead, the shaft is cooled with liquid nitrogen, and metal do shrink when the reduction in temperature happens, and there is a small reduction is there with the capability inserted here and just allowed to expand it by room temperature, and again it comes back to expand a bit and make very tight joints. Okay, and it's completely, it's impossible to remove the joint. Okay, so this kind of a shrink fitting is happening in very in all the Indian railways, the wheels and axles, they uses deploy this kind of a thing, and very crucial area where we want to have a ship to be inserted, used for the shrink fitting using liquid nitrogen cooled thing. Okay, and entertainment industries also uses liquid cryogenics, and there are, if it is an indoor area, they put the liquid air, and then when it expanded with the light, laser light, it gives a very high, good ambience. Okay, so air contains oxygen and nitrogen, so there's no problem. There are also called kind of water fire. You in the middle of a pond, in a lot of water fires are available in Dubai as a kind of a show. You just inject liquid oxygen and then ignite it. Suddenly, so the controlled way of you are injecting high pressure oxygen in an open interface, and with the fire, you can have a controlled fire, and a high pressure fire is possible. So this kind of a thing usually done in outside in a kind of middle of the pond. So that also been used heavily in many places, and this is a very widely used application is about the nitrogen dosing. There are large PET bottles. In fact, all the food components now coming in from is preserved in the food PET bottles. When the PET products are made, or the bottles are made in some other location, and filling station is somewhere else. So during the transit, normally what happened, that bottle is made and then cap it, and the transit, when they come to the filling station, they remove the cap, flush the bottle, and then ready for filling with the thing. And also there are many bottles damaged during the transit. Dents all happen. So to avoid that, what they do is at the time of production, at the production facility, before capping, they put few drops of liquid nitrogen inside and cap it. Nitrogen is an inert gas, and it does not need any pressure, and it forms when it expands. Liquid nitrogen expands 700 times. 1 liter of liquid nitrogen, when it expands, is 700 liters of gas. So few droplets, huge quantity, it forms a very tight pack. Even if you stand on the bottle, nothing, there's no dent is there. And when it comes to the filling station, just uncap it, nitrogen goes out, it's inert gas, nothing is there. So again, you can directly fill it. So this way, the transit losses and the production filling time is enhanced here. So all the bottles in the production, they also have the nitrogen dosing is done, particularly in the food grade bottles are there. And finally, cryogen is used for the sports injury, cryotherapy service, or cryosauna, or the sports injury. So most of the sports injuries are treated for a quick relief using the cold vapors of liquid nitrogen. It's just splashed over the body so that the particular point have a quick recovery is possible. There are very large pups are there. In fact, you can have a walk-in through the helium thing like this. You can stay in a cold vapor for a few minutes. So you get that your skin exfoliated and your glow in your skin is possible. So that as a cryotherapy is possible. So there are so many other applications are also there. And I've seen with this, I'm going to wind up with another 2 minutes about our mentioning about my facility, which is low temperature facility. We started liquid liquefying, resin finish started in about 6 decades, now 1962. And facility produces liquid nitrogen and liquid helium along with various support services. It's a fully automated procedure facility. We have provided technical assistance to various other facilities and academic institute. And it's just about the our growth or the history of liquid helium in TIFR. The first plant, which is the ADL Collins plant. I mentioned that the Collins plants were came in market in 1950s. 1952 was the first plant of Asia came into nuclear NPL, National Physical Laboratory in Delhi. And this is the second plant in 1962 came to TIFR. It's a piston-based plant. And later, after 10-15 years, we changed to, again, Coach plant, which is again a piston-based plant. And then 1991, again, we went for the bigger piston-type plant, which is in 2002. And then recently, the current plant is a turbine-based plant, which is all, they are all two cylinder based on this choline cycle. This on the modified Eklund cycle, it can produce about 100 liter per hour. We started somewhere around 5 liter per hour to now 100 liter per hour. This is the growth of the thing. And similarly for the nitrogen, we used for the Philips plant, liquid nitrogen plant. Again, Philips plant in, I think in third plant, we went for the turbine based plant using the distillation of liquid air. And now we are going to the PSA based, you know, the PSA will produce liquid, produce nitrogen gas, and nitrogen gas is condensed in a cryo refrigerator. Using that cryo refrigerator, we can show. So these are all the kind of our growth. And with that, and I will end, and our application of cryogenics in usage of cryogenics input, all the departments uses cryogenics in one way or other, except in fact put, I used to say that except mathematics and computer science, everybody uses the cryogenics in one way or other. And there are so many experimental setups. I get only few setups which uses liquid helium are shown here. All these setups are cooled with liquid helium and they are in liquid helium temperature since its installation. Okay. So with that, I end and I thank you very much for your thing. And my special thanks to Professor Hardik Shukla for giving me this opportunity. And thank you very much for your patience.
Thanks a lot, sir. Any faculty can take this session at least in 4 to 5 hours. With so much energy and with so much dedication, you delivered, sir, for students and for experts and faculty members. Thanks a lot, sir. I request any participant if you have any question in our team.
There are some questions I'm seeing in QA session. One is about the what is the material for cryogenic machining nozzle. There are same machining materials are there. Only the nozzle, they made a groove. If it is to be on the groove, they make a groove and then inject the CO2 thing. If it is not there, they put it as a totally a different setup. It just focus that nozzle to the machining area. But cryogenic machining nozzle, normally they used to go for a Teflon-based one because that is the only thing which can doesn't go brittle at that low temperature. And next question is, what precaution to be considered while storing liquid nitrogen in Dewar flask? I when you say that Dewar flask, I assume that you are mentioning about the normal thermos flask, what you have keep it in a household thing. Yes, we can keep it, but only thing is, if it goes for the sudden cooling, the glass may crack. But if it is a metal thing, probably there are, you also given metal flasks are available that can be used for liquid nitrogen for a short duration of thing. But proper, we have to go for a proper liquid nitrogen Dewar where you can store for about a month or so. The third question is about the precaution in delivery of nitrogen. In fact, not even nitrogen, any cryogenic material safety is very much involved because I have not included the slides about the machining. In fact, like whatever it happens with hot oil, exactly same thing happens with the cryogenics also, but here it is much worse. You know, it eats your pigment. It leaves a permanent mark on your body. So it's much worse compared to those things. And I do not see other question.
Yes, sir. In chat box, one fellow has asked which experiments are performed at micro Kelvin temperature level.
Okay. So, no, the application, what do you do with the experiment? Basically, they study at the quantum level experiment and to study the material as superconductor, whether it becomes superconductor. For example, even now, we don't know the transition temperature of the noble metal, like, you know, silver, gold, platinum. These we don't know the oxygen. So these questions going for even micro Kelvin also. So we have various applications are there, various experiments are there where we to need a micro Kelvin, because whether we know whether gold can go transition, go to superconductor at micro Kelvin, no, it has not gone. So to need to study that up to micro Kelvin, we need to go. That's one of the experiments. The other question what I see is how oxygen is separated in air separation units in Inox and Linde. Yeah, which I mentioned that you use the Linde process or the Linde process to liquefy the air and goes to a separation column, like what you do, the distillation column, the exactly the way what you do for crude oil, you know. So you just pass to various column as that you add a heat load. So if it goes up, as it goes up, only the boiling point, lower boiling point fluid gas will go up and higher boiling point will go up. For example, oxygen settle at the bottom, nitrogen goes up. CO2 will come at the bottom most time. So the depending upon the location, we know the vapor pressure curve and at what temperature we can pull. So you just tap it from that point, you can take the oxygen out or the argon out or the nitrogen out, depend upon that thing. Where you can get. So that length of the column, distillation column will decide the purity. For example, in PSA system, we are not able to remove the adsorbent, cannot distinguish between nitrogen, oxygen or argon. Both are in the same link. So whatever impurity we get is also argon mixed. So it's going to go more than 95%, 93 to 95%. Whereas in distillation column, you remove in the column height is increased quite a bit or 40 feet column to be so that we can remove the carbon dioxide, nitrogen to the purity of 99.999 and then argon, nitrogen, everything can be removed. So this is how the length of the column will decide the purity. Can we use other than flexible hose for liquid nitrogen delivery pipes? In fact, normally better option would be to go for SS bellow and make a local insulation with a puff insulation, which will do the process. The plastic may brittle. You can go for a Teflon or silicon hose pipe. Better would be that when there is a movement is quite far, the flexibility is also need be assured. The better to go for an flexible bellow pipe, which is in, you can insulate. You can go for a vacuum insulation or you can make a local insulation like a normal puff.
Okay, so I think any more question from any anyone from the audience? Thanks to all for participating, and thanks, sir. We have Mr. Rohit Dave sir, who is the motivational speaker from Vadodara. We have Ruchir Parikh sir, who is our committee member, and Mr. Gaurang Patel ji, who is also a committee member and president elect for East Ahmedabad chapter. And so we are thankful on behalf of whole team members, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you all.
Sir, I would like to specially mention here, basically I had done my master's in cryogenics. It is almost like 14 years back. But after going through your sessions, like within a 1 hour, I had like refreshed my entire 2 years, whatever I learned. It was a really wonderful sessions. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much. Thanks for
Hardik, let me speak few words, please. Hardik, will you please allow me to speak few words?
Sir. Yes, you can, sir.
Gaurang, see, I also agreed with you. Said I have operated cryogenic distillation in my GSFC career. The cryogenic distillation tower I have operated by my hand because I am a chemical engineer. But the Srinivasan sir have given the information is encyclopedia wise. Sir, I really salute you. You have given the information in 1 hour or 1 hour and 20 minutes is something like encyclopedia. Sir, I really salute you. And
thank you. Thanks for your
That's right. Sir, really, I say that anybody else apart from Srinivasan sir will need minimum 4 hours to cover.
Yes, exactly. So congratulations even and salute and thank you to Isra Ahmedabad chapter, Gaurang, Hardik and all. Said you have bring such a brilliant and respected and most appreciated faculty. Really, I am thankful. Really, I am thankful to East Ahmedabad chapter.
Thank you, sir. I am really, honored by this thing. In fact, a special thanks to Hardik ji because he has given me the opportunity. And but I have been interacted with Hardik thing for so many days. In fact, I am the byproduct of LD College thing. So in that way, I have a little more connection and to the heart. Okay.
So I'm basically regular opportunity to students. So it's our privilege to have an opportunity to listen to you.
No. Hardik, you have researched a gem. आपने एक हीरा को ढूंढ निकाला और आपने उसे बुलाया. रियली आई कांग्रेचुलेट यू एंड श्रीनिवासन सर, आपके लिए तो मैं जो बोलूं वो कम है.
आई एम रियली हॉनर्ड सर, थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर योर अप्रिसिएशन. एंड
any of these thing. And basically, we as a TFR, we are also promoting the science outreach. You know, it's a part of outreaching our knowledge and expertise to the various students, particularly the students' community, so that they get provoked. You know, what I see that I'm more interesting. What I see, the same thing I wanted to have that feeling to go to the students' level. So many more people are encouraged to take up in cryogenic thing, which is a very huge potential is there. So when we had cryogenic subject, in fact, LD College and IIT Kharagpur is the only college which gives cryogenics. Nowadays, even now, even after about 30 years of my degree, we have only one more college, not so specialized as a cryogenics. Not, I'm not getting ME in cryogenics except IIT Kharagpur and LD College. Nobody else. There is maybe a part of that. So even at that time, even that point of time, so many hours also, now the opportunities have gone tremendously high, and particularly the Western belt of India is a hub of cryogenic. All the large plant like, you know, IPR and BRC, TIFR, IIT Bombay, and all the industries, in fact, they are lying in the Western zone. So in that way, the Western zone has a very, very large need to promote those knowledge to other parts. And that's the reason, that's also part of that. So anyway, so in that way, I should thank you.
Sir, basically, you have explained the usability of cryogenic thing in more than 10 sectors. And that is a great thing. It is a great
thing. Thank you. Thank you very much.
One sentence I am adding here. You have told many things about oxygen, and we are in scarcity of oxygen nowadays. We are in tremendous scarcity. Oxygen ke liye to abhi jhagde ho rahe, political affairs ho rahe. I give one information on my research and on my reading that people are traveling and going to rather their ultimate destination. Is Mars. Mangal pe jane pe liye log soch rahe. And the unfortunate thing is that in the atmosphere of Mars, there is only 0.1% oxygen. Only 0.1% oxygen. We, in our Earth, we are having 21% oxygen. And in Mars, only 0.1% oxygen. So the biggest challenge for the scientists and NASA is to first increase the oxygen there, or to take more oxygen with them and then to land on Mars. This is my I am reading, sir. Only 0.1%. But this is my only one adding. But thanks, sir, I'm really thankful you have given a wonderful.
Thank you. It's my pleasure. It's my pleasure, sir.
Hardik, thank you very much.
And thank you.
It's the chapter Ahmedabad. Very thankful to you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank
you very much, sir.
Gorang, thank you. Thank you, Gorang.
Sir, actually, I also would like to thanks on behalf of student one, because what happens, as you rightly said, that for cryogenics there are only two colleges in India, LD and the Kharagpur. But I had been the students there, and I was also facing at the time the opportunities available with the cryogenics engineers.
Okay. Yes.
And in your presentation, you had shown number of applications where the cryogenics comes into pictures and where the cryogenics engineers are required. So that also gives a very good vision to the students who had participated in the webinar today. So thank you for that one too. On behalf
thanks, sir. Thanks,
chapters thank and you, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you
very much, sir.
Shall I log off now?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Thank you. Yes, sir.